Welcome, everyone. The Bible says this: I was glad when they said, let's go to the house of the Lord. Now, I know that you're sitting around, maybe driving or listening, but for those of you who are joining us online, whether it's Saturday night or Sunday morning, and you're streaming the service, welcome. I am so glad that you're here. But we've been talking every weekend about set aside your devices, and I know how that goes. You're going to be on them anyway, and I'm not telling you you should stop, but sometimes you feel like, okay, boys and girls, we're going to worship. Jesus is here. Let's focus in on him. So there it is. Let's focus in on Jesus. Are you ready to worship, sing, give thanks to God, and to hear a message from the Word of the Lord? Here we go. Let's sing. Let's worship. Let's pray. Let's celebrate.
Hey, everyone. Welcome to church. It is time to worship the Lord together. So wherever you're at, we invite you to worship with us. Let's lift our hands in praise to the God who is liberator of our lives. Come on, let's worship together. Amen. We'll be right back.
grateful, God, that you set us free, and that whom the Son sets free is free indeed. Right now, we worship a God who sees us in our brokenness. We worship a God who sees us in our humanity. And Lord, here we are, ready and willing and humble to worship you, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, the God who sets us free. Thank you for your presence. In Jesus' powerful name. In Jesus' powerful name. Well, GB Christian, we are so grateful that you are with us today. It's another great day to worship Jesus. I hope and pray that God enters into the space where you are and you're able to focus your attention on him. He's the author and he's the perfecter of your faith and mine. And so easy for us, very easy for us, just to stop and focus your attention on him. And as you do, he'll meet you exactly where you are. He will set you free. Come on, let's continue to worship Jesus together. Oh, Lord, we are so grateful that you are good and you are God. Thank you, Lord. Sing together, don't lose heart.
Oh my soul, don't give up, there is hope, there is always hope,
always hope in you, Jesus.
And there is peace in the storm, and don't forget, he is Lord of all.
Oh, come on, church, declare together, he's the King of glory. Say,
there is a King of glory. There is a God who saves. One who is strong and mighty. Freedom is in his name. Open the gates of heaven. Lift up a shout of praise. There is a lion roaring. Jesus, the King of glory.
Come on, sing it.
Bow, mountains shake at the sound of just one name. Over all, Jesus reigns. I know.
Come on, sing it again.
Nations bow, mountains shake at the sound.
Jesus, the King of glory. Amen. the grace of the Lord. Right where you are, I know that you're just like me, broken, messed up, sometimes bad intentions, bad motivations on the inside of my heart, doing things that are outside of my character, or at least what I want to be my character. And yet here I am, desperately in need of a Savior. Here you are, desperately in need of a Savior. Do you remember what it was like before you came to know Jesus? And the moment that you came to know grace firsthand, life changed. Life changed forever. Life changes because when grace is applied to the brokenness of our lives, man, everything begins to look different. Everything, you go outside and it's brighter outside. You experience life and there's more joy, there's more excitement, there's more happiness. Why? Because grace covers over no matter what you've done, no matter where you have been, no matter how many times you fall, God will pick you up again. He removes all of your shame. And he takes you and he takes me just as I am. But he doesn't leave us that way. He begins to change us so that we live for him every moment of every day by his incredible grace. Can we sing this bridge one more time together as we close our time of worship? Sing together. No matter what. Thank you for your grace. Come on, right where you are. Maybe you would just by lifting your hands in your home, wherever you are, and just say, God, thank you for your grace for me. Thank you for your grace for me. Thank you for calling me out by name. Thank you, Jesus. I don't deserve it. I've done nothing to earn it. But somehow, God, you've called me out. And today I'm saying thank you. Today I'm saying thank you for your grace and your mercies that are new for me. And all of us every morning. Jesus, thank you. I love you so much. Thank you for your grace. And everybody in your living rooms, or your bedrooms, or your kitchens said a good amen. Come on, somebody said amen. Amen and amen. Hallelujah, Jesus. We love you so much. We give you praise.
Hey, GV Christian family, we are so excited to welcome you home next weekend, October 18th, Sunday morning at 9 and 11 a.m. We have worked as hard as we can to do everything we can to provide as safe, spacious, and sanitized a facility as we can for you and your family to come home to. We just wanted to give you a quick heads up on what to expect when you come back next weekend, because we've had to put some protocols in place to ensure as best we can your safety, the safety of others, and to stay within the state guidelines so that we can keep our doors open. So I'm going to take you through these procedures real quick. You guys ready? This is what to expect. First, throw on a mask before you come in the doors, just like so. Pow! You've been doing this everywhere you go. I know you're used to it. Maybe you don't love it. That's okay. But then once you have your mask on, come on, follow me. Here we go. At the door, somebody's going to open the door for you and have a contactless thermometer. Take your temperature. Thanks, Michelle. And you're going to get some hand sanitizer. Thanks, Shelby. Rub that in. We're gonna head on inside. On your way in, we just ask that with anybody else that you're walking around, maintain 6 feet social distancing. You'll be able to check in your kids right over here, but you won't have to touch the screen. We'll have a representative from NextGen who will check your kids in for you if you have kids that you're putting in kids ministry. Once you come on inside the worship center, as you can see, man, we've had to do some changes in here, but it's awesome. Look at this. We got all kinds of space. What's up, Pastor Becca?
Hey, everybody. Welcome back to our safe, spacious, and sanitized worship center. We're going to ask that you keep 3 chairs between you and another family so that everybody is as safe as possibly can be. We are excited to welcome you back October 18th.
It's going to be awesome. Welcome home.
Welcome home.
Hey, I better get ready to go do
this
thing.
Come on, go get it. Go get it done.
Got to bring the word. Hey, let's go. Here we go.
Oh my gosh. What's up, everybody? Holy cow, did you see that? We're continuing this week through our series of messages called Falling. And of course, I tripped on a chair on the way up here and almost did just that, right? Welcome home, GV Christian family! Oh my goodness. If you got your Bibles, you know what I want you to do. Hold them up in the air, wave them at me, and say, word! We are getting into the Word this weekend. I am so excited to share this message with you. We're going to be in Ezekiel chapter 47. Ezekiel chapter 47 this week as we're getting into the Word. Ezekiel is one of my favorite books in the Bible. There's some weird parts, don't get me wrong, when it talks about like wheels with eyes and stuff. That's like, I don't know. Ezekiel was doing something weird while he was praying. Okay, but there's some powerful prophecy, some amazing promises of God in this book. And I'm so excited to go here this week. Now, you've heard us say this before. During this pandemic, church has never been closed. Amen? We may not have been able to meet in person, but we are reaching more people than ever before. We have not had to reduce ministry, and that is a miracle in and of itself. Can I get a big amen for that? There you go. Type it in the comments. Throw it up there. Throw some clap emojis, all that kind of stuff. We've not had to reduce ministry. We've been able to expand and extend ministry all over the world, sending aid to people affected by hurricanes, sending help to people affected by wildfires, and sending support to projects and missionaries around the world. Now, can I tell you something crazy? The last time we had a large gathering at our church was the crab feed on March 13th. What in the, can you believe that, right? That's crazy. But here's something crazier. Because of your generosity and the hard work and generosity of our missions team, we still are doing a 2020 missions project in Nicaragua. Okay, I'm so excited. We may not be able to bring our team in person like we had hoped all the way back at the beginning of the year when we were starting to meet and train and plan and prepare. But this week, we just sent off $15,200 to our missionaries in Nicaragua, Bonnie and Levis Hernandez, to go to a school that is falling apart and needs to be completely redone in a place called Lirio de los Valles in Sabaco, Nicaragua. That's my best. I'm doing my best, okay? I sent an email to our missions team members this week and encouraged them with this. We may not have been able to go this year, but God gave us a chance to send. Amen? And every penny we sent will carry the weight of eternity and the blessing and anointing of the God of all creation behind it. Every penny sent will go directly to redoing this school that so desperately needs help and reaching those kids and families for the kingdom of God for years and years to come. God is so good. And his kingdom continues to grow. His great will is being done. And through all the difficulties and trials and battles that we are facing, we get the privilege here and now, made for just such a time as this. We get the privilege of taking part in one of the most powerfully effective and transformative times in modern history. I can't wait to see what God does next from here. in us, through us, for us, around us. Can we pray right now as we're getting ready to get into the Word? Oh God, you are so good. And you're bigger than all these things that are being blasted in our faces in the news daily. You're bigger than politics. You're bigger than racial divide. You're bigger than COVID and any plague that has ever plagued mankind. Your faithfulness goes to all people in all time. And God, we thank you for the opportunity we have now to welcome home our church family, to bring everyone back together. And God, we ask and continue to ask for revival, for an outpouring of your Spirit like we have not seen in our generation. So pour out your Spirit, God, in Jesus' name. Now bless your word. Open hearts and minds and ears to come to a better understanding of you, who you are, and your plan and your purpose. In Jesus' name, amen. We are in the series called Falling, and fall, man, fall is like my favorite time of year. It's just all about being cozy, right? Like, you just want to wear a sweater and some fluffy socks and drink a nice hot pumpkin spice latte. Right? Ah, fall. Everybody loves fall. Oh, it's so fun. My wife loves the fall because her birthday is the first day of fall. So she says fall kicks off the Christmas season. But last week we kicked off this series with a message called Falling Up. If you missed it, man, get online, you go check it out. But here's what we heard. Sometimes you build on the sand, sometimes you build on the rock. And when you build on the sand, you goof up, you make mistakes, outright sin. You can either make excuses, place blame, or take responsibility. So we talked about building on the rock. How do we build on the rock? By falling up. We heard from what Jesus said in Matthew 21 and Luke 20 about the cornerstone, that anyone who falls on this cornerstone will be broken to pieces. Anyone on whom it falls will be crushed. And this is how we learned to fall up. We have to fall onto him. We have to let all of our pride, all of our arrogance, all those things that keep us up, fall to the wayside so that we are broken to pieces in him, so that we can reach people like never before for him. And we have to let the rock fall upon us so we are crushed. This week, we're continuing through this series, Falling, with a message titled, Falling In. I had you turn to Ezekiel 47 just a moment ago. It's at the end of a very long and elaborate vision of a new temple and a new city of God that starts in Ezekiel 40 and goes through the end of the book. So in Ezekiel 47, beginning verse 1, let's just go there right now. Ezekiel says this, in my vision, the man brought me back to the entrance of the temple. Wait, the man. The man, in my vision, the man. Who's the man? What man? Now listen, I got to pause here. You know I always got to pause here. Sometimes I just got, I love to go back and see who is this dude, right? This guy shows up throughout the Word of God. This guy is described using very similar language every time he appears. Let me just take you through some of the more well-known places. Let's go back to Ezekiel chapter 40, right? So Ezekiel chapter 40, so that's the beginning of this vision, this very lengthy vision that describes the new temple of God, the new city of God. And at the beginning of this vision, Ezekiel 40, it says, in a vision from God, he took me to the land of Israel and set me on a very high mountain. From there, I could see toward the south what appeared to be a city. As he brought me nearer, I saw a man who gleamed and whose face shone like bronze, standing beside the gateway entrance. He was holding in his hand a linen measuring cord and a measuring rod. He said, son of man, watch and listen. Pay close attention to everything I show you. You've been brought here so I can show you many things. Then you will return to the people of Israel and tell them everything you have seen. Now, this is not the first time Ezekiel has seen this guy. In fact, Ezekiel saw him before. In Ezekiel chapter 1, beginning of verse 25, it said, there came a voice from above and high above the throne. There was a figure like that of a man. In verse 27, I saw that from what appeared to be his waist up, he looked like glowing metal, as if full of fire. And that from the waist down, he looked like fire. Brilliant light surrounded him, like the appearance of a rainbow in the clouds on a rainy day. So was the radiance that shone around him. This was the appearance of the likeness of the glory of the Lord. When I saw it, I fell face down and heard the voice of one speaking. He's in the Old Testament in other places. Daniel, the book of Daniel chapter 10, Daniel has a vision. He says this, I looked up and saw a man dressed in linen clothing with a belt of pure gold around his waist. His body shined like a precious gem. His face flashed like lightning and his eyes flamed like torches. His arms and his feet shone like polished bronze and his voice roared like a vast multitude of people. One of the most famous descriptions of this guy comes from the very end in the book of Revelation. It says this in Revelation chapter 1, verse 12. I turned to see who was speaking to me, and I saw seven golden lampstands, and in the middle of those lampstands was someone like a son of man. He was wearing a long robe with a gold sash around his chest. His head and his hair were like wool, white as snow, and his eyes were like flames of fire. His feet were like polished bronze refined in a furnace, and his voice thundered like the mighty oceans. He held seven stars in his right hand, and a sharp two-edged sword came from his mouth, and his face was like the sun in all of its brilliance. Who is the man? Well, Revelation chapter 1, verse 17, John tells us, when I saw him, I fell at my feet as if dead. But he laid his right hand on me and said, don't be afraid. I am the first and the last, the King of kings and Lord of lords, the name above all names. I am the living one. I died, but look, I'm alive forever and ever. And I hold the keys of death and the grave. Who's the man? The man. The man, Jesus Christ himself, the Son of God, the Prince of Peace, the Great I Am, the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last, the King of kings and Lord of lords, the name above all names, that at his name every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that he is Lord. This is a pre-incarnate vision of Christ himself. You know, Jesus shows up in almost every book of the Bible, right? At some point. And we can't prove and be like, oh yeah, that's Jesus. But it's like, okay, who else could that possibly be? So back to Ezekiel chapter 47. In my vision, the man brought me back to the entrance of the temple. And I saw a stream of water coming out from under the threshold of the temple toward the east. For the temple faced east. The water was coming down from under the south side of the temple, south of the altar. He brought me out through the north gate and led me around the outside of the outer gate facing east. And the water was trickling from the south side. As the man went eastward with a measuring line in his hand, he measured off 1,000 cubits. And then led me through the water that was ankle deep. He measured off 1,000 cubits and led me through water that was knee deep. He measured off 1,000 cubits and led me through water up to the waist. He measured off 1,000 cubits, but now it was a river that I could not cross because the water had risen and was deep enough to swim in, a river no one could cross. He asked me, son of man, do you see this? I feel like his answer would be, yeah, I totally see it, right? He's in it, up to his neck. He's floating. He's treading water, if he even knows how to do that. He is swimming. Do you see this? He said. And then he led me back to the bank of the river. When I arrived there, I saw a great number of trees on each side of the river. He said to me, "This river flows east through the desert to the Dead Sea. When it empties into the sea, the salty water there becomes fresh and pure." It's a river flowing from the new temple, flowing from the new city of God, flowing out and turning dead things alive again, bringing new life to the death that had filled the valleys. And you see the Dead Sea here used in a very prominent place. The Dead Sea is dead. It is literally just a salty, briny sea. Now, I've never been to the Dead Sea. I would love to go to the Dead Sea. I know Gary and Meg, they've been to the Dead Sea. They floated in it. I would love to go do that. Okay, so, but here's the thing. I haven't been to the Dead Sea, but I've been to the Great Salt Lake in Utah. And while it's not quite the same thing, the salinity levels are similar in that when the Salt Lake is at its lowest point, it is about 27% salty. And the Dead Sea is about 33% salty. So there's a little 6% difference. And here's what I saw at the Great Salt Lake. Well, first of all, let me just give you a little background. We went on a road trip this summer. We were driving through Utah, went to Park City. Beautiful. So cool. You got the Olympic Training Center. It's awesome. We were going to go from there up to Yellowstone National Park. Also awesome. We saw a bison. It was so cool. We thought, oh, it's just a quick hour and a half out of the way to go see the Great Salt Lake. If you ever have that thought, just don't. It's gross. It smells. I mean, if you've ever been to the ocean, imagine like when you're at like a fisherman's wharf and you got that salty, rotten smell times like 1,000. Then the salt in the Great Salt Lake is so briny that there are warning signs everywhere. Rinse off if you go in the water because it will irritate and burn your skin. The only thing that survives in the lake are these weird species of brine shrimp. And then on the shore of the lake, what's thriving are what's called brine flies, which are these gross, teeny, tiny little black flies that love to clump together so that when you're walking, you think, oh, weird, the sand is black. No, it's not. The flies are. And when you get closer, they go like a big cloud. It's like you're walking through a plague in Egypt. Now, you know what loves to eat brine flies? Our giant spiders. So in the places where there's rocks on the side of the shore, there are spiders that are the freaky-deakiest thing I've ever seen. Check out these spiders. They were everywhere. Now listen, I know it's hard to see from where you are, but in this one picture alone, I couldn't even capture it. There are no less than 200 spiders in these rocks. All of these are all webs crisscrossed. Ah. We were like, why did we come here? My kids were like, can we swim? We're like, sure, we just need to follow the warning signs and make sure you rinse off so that your feet don't melt. But why not get in the water? My son comes back literally 30 seconds later. He goes, it felt like I was walking in dog poop. So glad we came here. It's a great vacation destination. Okay, but listen. It gave me this amazing picture. Okay, it's dead, right? There's nothing that can thrive and live there. But here's this river flowing into the Dead Sea, flowing into that which was dead and bringing life. And in verse 9, it says, multitudes of living creatures will thrive where the river flows. There will be large numbers of fish because the water flows there and makes the salt water fresh. And listen to this, life will flourish where this water flows. Fruit trees of all kinds will grow on the banks of the river. Their leaves will not wither. There will always be fruit in their branches. Every month they will bear fruit because the water from the sanctuary flows to them. Their fruit will serve for food and their leaves for healing. This passage. Now, it's mainly dealing with God's promised restoration. And especially the restoration of life that he offers. There's so much here in this short passage. Honestly, I could probably preach 5 different messages from here. You're a tree on the shore. Dig your roots deep. Suck the water in so you can bear fruit that will give life and bring healing, right? What the heck? Like, just write that down right now. That's a good one to write down and take notes on, because that, dig your roots deep into that river, okay? Grow out, bear fruit. Let it be nourishing to everyone you encounter, everywhere you go, bring life. Okay, but that's not where we're going. This week we're talking about falling in. And I want to ask you the question, how deep will you fall in? As Ezekiel was following the man, he said, he measured off 1,000 cubits and I followed him. And the water was up to our ankles. Will you fall in to your ankles? I feel like falling into your ankles is more of an accident than an intentional thing, right? A couple years ago, we were on what's called the Do Something Day here at our school. And I accompanied a group of kids to do a Lake Mead shore cleanup. So we went and we brought a bunch of trash bags. We were just cleaning up trash on the shore. And there was a kid who was out doing his thing. We're like, Tommy, get away from the edge of the water. And he's like, huh? And he goes, ankle deep, right? Wearing his Jordans. You shouldn't wear your Jordans. Okay. Oh, but that almost feels like an accident, right? You go ankle deep. It's not necessarily intentional, unless maybe you just want to get your feet cooled off and wet in a creek somewhere. But here's, okay, so ankle deep. Will you go ankle deep? James chapter 1, verse 8, in incredible translation I found called the Passion Translation, says this: when you are half-hearted and wavering, it leaves you unstable. Can you really expect to receive anything from the Lord when you're in that condition? All right, so Ezekiel says he measured off 1,000 cubits. I followed him. The water came up to our knees. Will you fall in to your knees? This is waiting, right? People like waiting. May sound good and spiritual, but remember, notice I said fall into your knees, not onto your knees, right? Like, so this is different. So we want you to fall on your knees. That's a good thing to do. So pray, okay? But this saying, fall into your knees. So he fell into his knees. So this is maybe a little bit more intentional. Maybe you're getting a little bit deeper. Maybe you're like feeling the coolness and you're like, ooh, that's nice, right? Like when it's a hot day and you're waiting up and you're like, ooh, I like it. Or maybe you're a fisherman and you put on some waders and you pull them up and you want to get closer to the fish because they're in the water, right? And you throw out your pole because you got your waders on and you like to wade. You want to get up to your knees. So you're feeling that little bit of a flow, a little bit of a tug, a little bit of a pull. And you're like, okay, that's nice. James chapter 4, verse 8 says, come near to God. He'll come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, purify your hearts, you double-minded, grieve, mourn, and wail. Change your laughter to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves before the Lord and he will lift you up. Come nearer to him and he will come nearer to you. Okay, so says he went a little further. He measured 1,000 more cubits and the water was up to their waist. Now, waist deep, this is when you want to get wet, right? You go out to the ocean up to your waist. You're like, this feels good. I like to be out up to my waist. I want to be out up to my waist. Maybe you're in an inner tube and you're floating along. You're up to your waist. You're having a good time. You're splashing a little bit. You're kind of beginning to commit yourself to this a little bit, to throw yourself into this a little bit. You definitely are feeling the current flowing, but it's not quite carrying you yet. You still got your feet on the ground. You can resist it. You can stay where you want to stay because it's comfortable, it's cool, it's cozy, it's nice. Psalm 37:5 tells us, commit everything you do to the Lord. Trust in him and he'll help you. It says finally that he measured off 1,000 cubits, right? And when he did, he couldn't touch the ground. He was swimming. He couldn't even cross because the river was so powerful, so strong. The current was sweeping. And so will you fall in completely? Will you let the water sweep you away? Will you let that river of life that is flowing from him take you off your feet and carry you to wherever he will go, because wherever that river flows, he brings life. So will you swim in him? Will you jump into him? Will you fall in completely to him? Remember when I was 12 years old, this is the last time I saw my grandpa in a like real close personal setting. We used to go fishing every summer. And that summer was the first one he asked me to go by myself, just the two of us. So we went to our fishing spot. It was these rapids up in Colorado Mountains. And we would put on our waders, right? We had them up to our waist with the cool little suspenders, and we would toss our fishing poles out, and we would have some fun there, and we were catching fish. And I remember my grandpa had his little dog, and he was wading across this kind of really rough, like, flowing part. And he said, "You stay there. I'll come back and get you." And so he started to walk across. He went across. He set the dog down. And as he's coming back, I was like, "I got it. I'll come on my own." And I started to walk across on my own. And guess what happened? The current was too strong. The water was too deep. And 12-year-old me got swept off his feet. And I started to get carried down the river. To this day, I don't know how he did it, but my grandpa reached me before I was out of reach, caught me by the scruff of the neck, and yanked me out of the water. Probably saved my life. A month later, he died of a heart attack. To this day, I think about how he drew me out, right? But I also think about how powerful that current was. That was a very frightening moment for me. I couldn't swim in it. I couldn't catch myself on it. I couldn't put my feet down. And it's only because he pulled me out that I was able to get up and get out. But here's the thing. Even in the presence of God, that flowing river of life, sometimes that current will be scary. But we go where he lets us, we go where he flows and see where he takes. John chapter 7, I love this. "Whoever believes in me, scripture has said, rivers of living water will flow from within them." That new temple, that new city, it starts with us, right? Last week we talked about falling up, falling upon that stone, that cornerstone that is being built up into something bigger. You're a part of that something bigger as you are built up in him. You are part of that new temple as you are being built up in him. And now rivers of living water are flowing from you when you let him do what he's going to do in you. So, how deep will you fall in? How deep you fall depends on how far you follow the man. Ezekiel just kept following the man, just kept following where he led. He said he went another 1,000 cubits and the water was deeper. Went another 1,000 cubits and I followed him and the water was deeper. Went another 1,000 cubits and I followed him and the water was deeper. How far will you follow him? Because how far you fall depends on how far you follow. And here's the crazy thing about that. God even accounts for our humanity and our brokenness in this. In Matthew chapter 26, we see one of the final encounters that Jesus had with his disciples before he was betrayed and arrested. And Jesus looks at all of them and says, "Tonight, all of you are going to desert me." Peter declared, "Even if everyone else deserts you, I won't." Jesus replied, "I tell you the truth, Peter, this very night, before the rooster crows, you will deny 3 times that you even know me." "No," Peter insisted. "Even if I have to die for you, I will never deny you." And all the other disciples vowed the same. Peter followed him to the end, right? And God still knew and took account for Peter's humanity. We all know, right? If we've ever read the story, we've ever seen the gospel. If you don't know, I'll just tell you right now. Peter did. He denied him 3 times. Jesus was arrested. Peter stood out there by the fire. He could see Jesus far away as Jesus was being put on trial. He was standing by the fire. People started asking him, "Hey, aren't you one of the disciples?" "Nope, not me." "Hey, aren't you one of those that follow him?" "Nah, that was some other guy." "Hey, aren't you that one guy? No, it's not me. And then the rooster crowed, and one of the translations says, and Jesus looked at him. And Peter ran and wept. But then in the end of the book of John, we see Peter restored when he sees Jesus on the shore and he jumps in. He falls into the water and he swims to Jesus. And for every time that he turned his back on Jesus, Jesus restores him. So the last question I leave you with is this: how far will you follow the man? Jesus had sent his disciples ahead in the boat in Matthew 14. Well, he stayed behind to finish dismissing the crowd and went off by himself to pray. It says this: meanwhile, the disciples were in trouble far away from the land, for a strong wind had risen. They were fighting heavy waves. About 3 o'clock in the morning, Jesus came walking toward them, walking on the water. When the disciples saw him walking on the water, they were terrified. In their fear, they cried out, "It's a ghost!" But immediately Jesus said to them, "Take courage. It is I. Don't be afraid." "Lord, if it's you," Peter replied, "tell me to come out on the water." "Come," Jesus said. And Peter got out of the boat. And began to walk towards Jesus. But when he saw the wind and the waves, he was afraid. And beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me!" Immediately, Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. "You have little faith," he said. "Why did you doubt?" And when they climbed into the boat, the wind died down, and those who were on the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." How far will you follow the man? Will you dive in? Will you jump in? Will you fall in? Will you walk out on that water, even if you sink in the middle of the wind and the waves and the chaos and confusion around you? The fear? Will you fall in and swim in his presence and see where he carries you? Back in the day, this is a long time ago now, yikes. When I was a teenager, I had gone on my own path. I had started drinking, fighting, smoking, was not in a great place. I had grown up as a Christian. My parents made me go to church. They had a very strong faith. But I had seen the hypocrisy of Christians, and like so many others, I had rationalized that if this is what Christianity is, I don't want any part of it. I'd turn my back on it. I didn't want to be a Christian because of what I saw Christians were. I didn't like them. They were stupid and gross and ugly and mean and rude. Some of them still are. But I remember for my 16th birthday, my grandma got me a birthday present. Sent me to youth camp. Thanks, Grandma. As a kid who doesn't want to be around Christians, this is the perfect place to go. Trapped with 300 Christians for a week in the mountains. Awesome. First couple nights, I had my guard up. Wanted nothing to do with these people. Had that, like, stank teenage attitude. But one thing I noticed was the genuine heart of the people who were there. They weren't pretending to be anything. They weren't hypocrites. They were just broken people who were worshiping Jesus. Broken people who were desperately crying out to the one they knew they needed. And I remember on the third night of this camp, it was Wednesday night, I said to myself, all right, this I could get on board with. And maybe it's time to consider this. So on my own in the back of the room, separated from everyone else, leaning against the wall, arms crossed, I said, all right, God, if you're there, show me. I want to know. And now I know, then I didn't, but now I know it was a still small voice that spoke to me and said, close your eyes. I thought I was imagining things in the back of my brain, like getting all swept up in the emotionality of this Christian gooberness, right? I was like, whatever. Heard again, close your eyes. And I was like, what? No, stupid. Heard again, close your eyes. And I was like, get out of here. Heard again, close your eyes. Fine. Gah. So I closed my eyes. And standing in front of me was what I could only describe as a man made of light. Like if you could take a sunbeam and compress it into solid form, and he shined with brilliance. And I felt the warmth emanating off of him. And he stood before me with arms open wide and said, I'm here. I'm real. I love you. You're mine. And I was like, okay, this is weird. Whatever. He said it again. I'm here. I'm real. I love you. And you're mine. And he stepped forward. He began to approach me. And every time he took a step, he would repeat those words. I'm here. I'm real. I love you. You are mine. Now listen, I am not one to get swept up in emotionality and swept up in super spirituality. I can tell you at this point in my life in ministry, I have had three of what I consider to be real visions from the Lord. And this was the first and the most dynamic and life-changing. And in that moment, he stood directly in front of me, arms open wide, and said, I am here, I am real, I love you, and you are mine. And he wrapped those arms around me, and I felt real physical arms in that room, in that moment. And I opened my 16-year-old eyes, and I jumped back, ready to punch whatever freaky Christian just hugged me. Get out of here! But there was nobody nearby. And I heard it again, close your eyes. And I did. And he said it again, I'm here. I'm real. I love you. And you're mine. I gave my heart to the Lord in a real way for the very first time that night. And I've never been the same since. And years later, as I began to study the Word and dig into the Bible and discover all of what he had for me in this amazing story that he wrote, 66 books by 44 authors spanning 2,000 years that is just as relevant today as it was when it was written, I saw the guy who showed up in my life and changed everything. When I began to read these words, I saw a man whose face shone like bronze. He looked like glowing metal as if full of fire. Brilliant light surrounded him. The appearance of a rainbow in the clouds and radiance around him. A belt of pure gold around his waist. His body looked like a precious gem. His face flashed like lightning. His eyes flamed like torches. His arms and feet shone like polished bronze. Wearing a long robe and a gold sash across his chest. His head and his hair white like wool. Feet like polished bronze, eyes like flames of fire, face like the sun in all of its brilliance. I read these descriptions of the man and I said, I met that man. I saw him. I didn't describe him with those same words, but none of them described him with the same words. But they were seeing the same guy that I got to see in that moment that I needed to see him most. And to this day, I still hear his words. I'm here. I'm real. I love you. And you are mine. He's master of those kind of things. He said that to the disciples when he's walking on water and says, come walk with me. He says, take courage. It's me. Don't be afraid. And so here, as we conclude our time this weekend, as we wrap up this moment in the Word, I want you to know that no matter what you're facing in the world around you, no matter how scary things are, no matter what chaos and confusion and turmoil he still stands out there and says, take courage. It's just me. Don't be afraid. Can we pray together? As we pray and conclude our time, I cannot help but have to give this opportunity that maybe you don't know that man and you need to know him. He is the author of life, the author and perfecter of faith. He is everything. And he offers you eternity. And all you have to do to receive it is make a choice and simply speak it. We just pray this prayer with me. Dear Lord Jesus, I believe in you. You are the man. The man who showed up so long ago. The man who still shows up today. And I need you today. So Jesus, show up in my life and help me to do what you've called me to do. Teach me your word. Teach me your ways. Speak to me and speak through me. I just want to fall completely in to you and your power and your presence. I just want to find myself swimming in your river of life, your spirit, swept away by your presence and your power. Today, I choose to follow you wherever you may lead. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. We're going to end our time with communion this weekend. Hope you had a moment to gather your elements. We sent that out to remind you just a little bit ago. So whether it is crackers and water, whether it is cookies and juice, whether it is chips and salsa, I don't care, whatever it is. Listen, it's not a matter of what it is. It's a matter of the value you're placing on your heart because he says, do this in remembrance of me. So right here in my hand, I have these awesome little COVID-friendly single-serve communion cups that are completely sealed and they're really cool. So we're going to just go through this and I'm going to take this with you while you take this with me. In fact, this is how we're going to be taking communion for a little while, so I want to take you through just a quick tutorial. So on the top of this, there's a little clear plastic. We're going to take and just slowly peel that. Don't want to go too fast because that wafer will go flying, and then that's just a disaster, okay? But here's what we're going to do. We're going to take that wafer, right? Begin to think about his body broken for us. Because on the night he was betrayed, he took bread and broke it, passed around the table saying, this is my body. Broken for you. Take and eat. And every time you do this, do it in remembrance of me. His body broken and beaten, bruised and crushed, battered for us, nailed to that cross to pay a price we could never pay. He took the punishment that brought us peace. So you just lift whatever element you are using right now. Say, thank you, Jesus, for your body broken for me. Let's take it together. Word tells us that in the same way, after dinner, he took the cup and he passed it around the table and he said, this is the cup of the new covenant of my blood. There was an old covenant of blood that said that you had to kill something every time you sinned. Aren't you glad we don't have to do that anymore? Because he became the one final sacrifice for all people for all time. And so on this little thing, there's a little tab on the bottom. We're going to peel back the little foil here. Okay, check that out. And there is some juice inside. And whatever you're using, wherever you are, we just lift your cup with me. Jesus, thank you for a brand new covenant in your blood. Paying a price we could never pay, a price too great for us. But you paid it willingly because of how much you love us. And so we do this now in remembrance of you, to never forget the price you paid, to never take for granted what you have done. Thank you, Jesus. Let's take it together. He told his disciples, every time you gather together, do this in remembrance of me. And we do that because we are forgetful people. We have to be reminded sometimes of the price that was paid and why we get to have the life that is everlasting. This is not our life. Right here, right now, these shabby dwellings that we live in, they're falling apart anyway. He gives us life. And I can't wait to jump in and take a swim in that river of life. Will you join me? Oh, man. Let me say this blessing over you. Will you just stretch out your hands wherever you are and receive this from the Word of God? May the Lord bless you, protect you. May the Lord smile upon you, be gracious to you. May the Lord show you his favor, give you his peace. May you fall ever deeper into his presence as you follow him wherever he leads. Sweep us away, Lord, by your Spirit. Sweep us off your feet and into your life like never before. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Love you. For those who are comfortable, we will see you in person and welcome you home next week. If you're not ready yet, that's okay. We are still going to be bringing you online content, online services just like this every week. I can't wait to see you again. See you next time.
Hey everyone, this is Pastor Vic. What an incredible service. Part of our worship to the Lord is in our giving. And this weekend, or at any time, if you'd like to give, you can send your giving in to the address that's at the bottom of your screen, or by going on your computer or your mobile device to gvchristian.com/give. So it's been a great weekend, and we're even more excited about this coming weekend when we can all be together once again on Sunday the 18th at 9 and 11. And we're also excited to be working together to keep church safe, spacious, and sanitized. God bless you. Have an amazing week. We love you.